Dr. John Demartini is a human behavioral specialist and founder of the Demartini Institute, a private research and education institute dedicated to activating leadership and human potential. He's an international author and business consultant, working with CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, celebrities, and sports personalities. Globally, he's worked with individuals and groups across all markets, including entrepreneurs, financiers, psychologists, teachers, and young adults, assisting and guiding them to greater levels of achievement, fulfillment, and empowerment in all areas of their lives.
All right. Now I'm going to start by asking you a question. How many of you would love to have financial independence where you have so much money that that's not a concern? Raise your hand if you'd like to have that. Okay? I asked that question in about 60 countries, and invariably, I have people put their hands up. And then I ask people, and it's about 99 to 100% of the population says I'd like to have financial independence. It's probably a universal desire to not be stressed by the economics. I ask people that, and then I ask this question. How many of you have financial independence? We got one, two, three, maybe four. That means you have more money at the end of your life than life at the end of your money. Oh, you're working on it. Okay. Okay, so in the process. Okay, so are you in the process or you already have it? You say you have it. Okay, so if you never worked another day in your life, your passive investment income is equal to, no. So how many actually have it? They say that approximately 1% of the population obtain it. They're called the 1%ers. Now, the reason I ask that is to make one point, that the majority of people believe they want something, but then they don't demonstrate in their life's actions the reality that that's true. Let me reemphasize that. 99% of the population say they want financial independence, but only 1% obtain it. So that means 99% of the population live in a fantasy. Are you with me on that? Because only 1% obtain it, but everybody puts their hand up. So 99% of the population live in a fantasy that they're somehow, in some way, going to be financially independent. And yet, their actions do not lead them there. So why is there such a discrepancy between the people who say they want it, which is 99 to 100%, and yet only 1% obtain it? I'd like to discuss that. Because that's not but one area that people say they want to accomplish things and then don't obtain it. There's a whole lot of areas. In fact, seven areas of our life: our spiritual quest, our mind development, our financial, our career, our family, our social, and our physical health and well-being. All of us have ambitions and goals that we say we want in each of those areas, but we never get around to doing them. How many would like to have that perfect body? So there goes another 99%. How many have the perfect body? Who had their hand up? Come out here and show it, baby. Come strut your stuff. All right. So would you agree that a small percentage actually live and fulfill what they say they want? I have been fascinated by what I call the ambitions that people have, but then yet they don't follow through it. And I've always wanted to know, what is it that makes those distinctions? Why is it that some people do it, the small one percenters, and the rest of the people kind of fantasize about it and don't do it? Can I discuss that tonight? Because I think that's pertinent. The majority of people who say they want financial independence, if you gave them $10 million, which would be about 70 million rand, yes? If I gave you 70 million rand, the majority of people would spend it on depreciable consumables. They'd go buy a house that would depreciate in value. They'd go buy a car. They'd buy a trip. They'd go and get clothes. They'd get nice furniture. They'd buy things that depreciate in value. People who are the one percenters would immediately think of how they could turn that $10 million into $20 million. They buy things that appreciate in value because they value growing wealth. Approximately 1% of the population truly value wealth. Now, I've interviewed people who are extremely wealthy into the billions, and I've interviewed people that live in townships that have very little, if anything. And there's a distinct difference in what their priorities are and their values and what they value. When I mean by values, I don't mean just morals and ethic kind of values, but what we value most in our life. Because most people aren't aware of what their life is demonstrating. They've injected the social and idealisms and friends' value systems into their life and are fantasizing they're going to live according to them when in actuality their own values don't lead them there. Are you with me on that distinction? If a person doesn't truly value wealth building, it's not going to occur. The people who are billionaires or 100 million and up, and I'm thinking in dollars, but it could be more and multiply it times seven, I guess. They have a unique set of values and they truly value wealth building. They study it, they learn about it. Would you agree when you find something attractive, you want to study it, you want to learn about it? Yes? Would you agree if you're single or married, acting single, when you see somebody that you're attracted to, you want to get to know them? Yes? When you really, really want to know something, you study it, you want to learn about it. The average person does not study wealth building. 1% of the population has a library on wealth building of 100 books or more. The majority of people don't take the time to do it. So it's a fantasy. Now, is any time you set a fantasy and any time you set a goal that is not congruent and aligned with your highest, true, higher values, you end up with anger towards yourself, aggression towards yourself, you blame yourself, you feel like you betrayed yourself, you criticize yourself, you challenge yourself, you feel despaired, despondent, and depressed. The A, B, C, D's of negativity are a byproduct of expecting yourself to do something that's not truly valuable to you. And most people subordinate to outer influences, put other people on pedestals that they fantasize living the life of. We know that because a lot of people love watching celebrities' lives or reading gossip columns and reading about other people's lives, and they live vicariously this way and kind of live in a fantasy, oh, I wish I had that life, but they don't have the values that will lead them there. What's interesting, the very people that they fantasize about, I've had the opportunity to meet most of them, and in the process of meeting them, they don't have the life that people think. Does that make sense? So what they've done is they've minimized themselves, exaggerated others, injected the values of others into their life, fantasized those lives. They don't match their real values. They end up not living that. They beat themselves up. They have the ABCDs of negativity, and they're wondering what's wrong with them, when in fact there's nothing wrong with them. They're just expecting themselves to live outside their values. And they're living in fantasies. And fantasies breed nightmares. Your life becomes a nightmare when you compare it to a fantasy. Just like if you're married and you have this fantasy person or this fantasy magazine that you look at somebody, you don't always appreciate what you got. You don't appreciate your own life as long as you compare it to a fantasy. So it's important. The people who achieve the most are the people who identify what's truly valuable to them and set goals that are congruent and aligned with that, because then they increase the probability of actually achieving. Whenever you set a goal that is congruent and aligned with what's truly important to you, what your life really demonstrates, where you are really disciplined, where you do not require any outside motivation, when you are setting goals that are like that, you achieve them. You walk your talk. You awaken a natural born leader inside you. You're not limping your life and setting up fantasies and then having nightmares of experiences. So in order to live an amazing life, you first have to identify what's truly valuable to you, because that's the definition of the amazing life, what you really value. Not what somebody else does, but what you really value. Most people go through life and they have Monday morning blues, Wednesday hump days, thank God it's Fridays, week friggin' ends. They have most of their heart attacks on Monday because they got to go back to doing something that's not inspiring to them. They have been injecting the values of other people's in their life. They've been running a life that's not theirs. They hit the midlife crisis and they start to realize this isn't who I am. You know, it's interesting. People's values change. Would you agree when people are between 0 and 10 years old that they want to play? Kids want to play. And would you agree between 10 and 20, kids want to socialize? They're on their little text messages, they're socializing, things like that. When they're 20 to 30, they're trying to find that mate and they're trying to find that job. When they're 30 to 40, they want to stabilize and begin a family and they want to stabilize their career. When they're 40 and 50, they want to start affairs. And the reason why they found is because at that point they start to realize that the people that they fantasized that had a better life than them, they're now reaching a point where they are at that point that they thought they would be, and they realize it wasn't what they thought, and they go through this identity crisis and they're questioning themselves. It's wiser to know who you are right from the beginning, and there's ways of knowing that. So can I share those with you? Is this useful so far? We're just warming up here. Okay. Your life demonstrates your values. Life demonstrates it. If you look at what your life actually does and not what you fantasize it to be, it will reveal to you what's really important to you. Whatever's really, really, really important to you, what's truly valuable, nobody ever has to get you up to do. You're inspired spontaneously from within to do it. You do not require outside motivation to do what's truly most important to you. I love traveling and speaking, as you probably guessed. I full-time travel, I full-time speak. I love that. I've had a dream of doing that since I was 17. I've been doing it now, 39. I'll be doing it in November, it'll be my 40th year. So I've been doing it a long time. But what's interesting is nobody has to get me up in the morning to do it. Nobody has to remind me. I do not require outside motivation to do what I do. If you ever have to ask for outside motivation or reminders to do something, whatever it is that you're doing is not important to you, not highest. If you say, I keep sabotaging, I keep not staying disciplined, I keep forgetting things, I can't stay focused, all of that means that what you say is important to you isn't. Because what you're saying, I need to do, you're not really having as important. It's just like the beginning of the year when you start the New Year's resolutions, right? You heard of those? Every year when I do television and radio around New Year's Eve, that time frame, that's the most common question. How do you get people to stay focused on things after New Year's Eve resolutions? The New Year's Eve resolutions that you set are destined not to be going on, because if you were really important on, they're really important to you, you would already be doing them. It's just a fantasy. You overpigged out, so now you're going to lose weight, right? You overspent your money, so now you're going to save. It's just a fantasy because of what you've just done. But your actions of what you live is actually determining your destiny. The hierarchy of the values that you hold determines your destiny. So if you look at what your life demonstrates, it tells you what's really important to you. I have many people that say, oh, I'd really like to save, but I can't seem to get ahead. What it really means is that I have other things that are more important for me to spend money on that I keep spending my money on, and I never go around and get around to saving because I got more value on spending it than I do saving it. People that really value money, they put it away, pay themselves first, and then spend their money after they've already saved. So if you look carefully, there's some indicators, what I call value determinants. And I'm going to give you a brief introduction on this tonight, but if you'd like to go to my website, drdemartini.com. There's a whole 4-page summary of what to do to determine what they are. It's free. All you do is go drdemartini.com, go to the menu, go to value determination, and it's all there for you. You can just print it out if you want. But I'll just give you a highlight of it. If you look carefully, these 12 things will help you determine what's really important to you. Number one, look at how you fill your space. Look at how you fill your space. If I go to a company and I walk into their cubicle where they work and I saw pictures of their children everywhere and there was nothing but their children all over the place, what would it probably indicate? That they have a value on their children. That's important to them, yes? So you look at how you fill your space. If there were sport trophies everywhere, that's probably important to be able to be achieving in sports. If there's reference books and intellectual books everywhere, probably book writing, reading. Yes? If you saw pictures of their travels, then probably travel is important to them. Would you agree that something that's absolutely not important, it's zero of importance, it goes to the trash, the attic, or the garage? But if it's very important, you keep it around you. And the more valuable it is, the more you won't let it out. It's like if you're, how many have been married before? Or are married today? Okay? If you've been married and you just got married, would you agree that that ring is pretty vital, particularly to the female? Would you agree? They'll walk around and know. Yes? Because that's somehow... De Beers Marketing did a great job at making that important. If women really knew the value of a diamond, they probably wouldn't buy it, but they've been indoctrinated into doing it because of celebrities, diamonds, and things of this nature. It was marketing. But the point is, if it's really valuable, would you agree they don't let it out of their sight? And if they feel they lost it, they feel like, oh my God, I've died. Yeah. Okay, now, so whatever's really valuable to you, keep in your space. And whatever's not valuable, it goes to the trash, attic, or garage. So the first indicator of a value system is, what do you fill your space with? Look carefully. If you go to my office or you go to my personal space, you'll find books and literature because I'm reading all the time. I love learning. So you got to look at what you fill your space with. Is it beauty? Is it clothes? Is it shoes? Is it intellectual information? Is it entertainment? Is it videos? Would you agree that if you're a young boy who's 10 years old, it's probably video games? Yes? Because they got videos everywhere? So you look at how you fill your space. The second indicator is how do you spend your time and what do you always make time for? How do you spend your time and what do you always make time for? Because you find time for things that are really, really valuable to you. You squeeze that time other places to get at that time to do what's really important to you. And if you say, I can't seem to get around to doing the things, I keep being too busy, I can't get around to doing something, then whatever you say you get around to is not as valuable as whatever you're doing. Because you find the time for things that are important to you. I find the time for researching, writing, traveling, and teaching because I love that. That's my highest values. I always find time for it. So look at how you fill your space and how you spend your time. Those are two indicators. The third thing is, what is it that energizes you? Would you agree when you're doing something that's high in your values, that you love doing, that you're inspired by, you have more energy at the end of the day than when you started? You're energized, right, when you're doing it and the day zips by? And you find energy for it. Can I share a funny story? One night I'd been working on my computer till about 11:30. And my wife passed away about 7 years ago, so I've had a new girlfriend. And all of a sudden I was through with my computer and I went into the bedroom and she was getting ready to go to bed. She was in her little bunny outfit. So I sat on the bed next to her. And I said, you tired, honey? She goes, yes. Getting ready to go to beddy bye? Yes. Love you, honey. Love you, honey. Long day? Uh-huh. Ready to go to the dream world? Uh-huh. You want to make love? Uh-uh. And I said, honey? She goes, yes. Do you mind if I ask you one more question? Uh-huh, that's fine. I have a surprise for you. What's that, honey? Well, in an hour, I have a limousine picking us up. If you're up to it, and we're going to go on a private jet to Venice to go shopping for 3 days, as much as you can shop, and go to the spa and get beauty treatments and get massages and have a wonderful romantic 3 days. But if you're too tired, I can cancel it. Is she going to get up for it? Is she going to make love? Is she going to get up to go shopping? Okay, would you agree you always find energy for something that's really important to you? So you don't. Nobody has to remind you. You just automatically get up and do it if it's important to you. Yes? You're sitting there going, you want to go shopping in Venice, right? Yeah. Okay, so could you agree that you have the energy for things that are really important to you? That's the third indicator. Now, you'll find out that the thing you spend your time on, that fill your space with, and you energize are going to be matching. There's going to be overlaps. These are going to end up being similar because it's an indicator of values. The next one is what you spend your money on. How do you spend your money? Would you agree that you find money for things that are really important to you? Isn't it amazing? You may not pay the rent, but you buy your shoes. You're laughing because you know what I'm talking about. I just don't have enough for the rent this month. Yeah. So what happens is you always find money for things that are really valuable to you, but you run out of money for things that aren't. So that's the fourth indicator. The fifth indicator is, where are you most organized and ordered? If it's high value, socializing is high in your values, you'll have a social calendar that's full. If physical fitness is important to you, you'll have your fitness routine organized and organized. If money is important, your money and your business will be organized. If your business is important, then your business and management will be organized. You got it? If your house and your furniture is beautiful, then your house will be immaculate. Whatever's highest on your value is where you're organized and where you spend your time and energy and money and everything else I've been mentioning, and for how you fill your space with things that are important to you. These all indicate and point to certain things that your life demonstrates is important. And again, what is really demonstrated is what counts. The next one is, where are you most disciplined and reliable? What is it that we can always guarantee you're doing and we can rely on you being there and doing it? Where are you most disciplined and reliable? I'm disciplined and reliable. You know, you can guarantee I'm out speaking and I'm researching and traveling and speaking and doing things. You can rely on that. I do that every day. My girlfriend knows she's speaking. That's guaranteed. I know she's in fitness. She's going to be working out every day. She's never missed a day in workout. She works out every day in a beautiful shape. That's high in her values. Mine is my brain and teaching, and hers is her bod and her beauty. Yes? It's very common, isn't it? Very common pattern. Not everybody has it, but it's a very common pattern. So you look at where you're disciplined, reliable, and focused. The next indicator is what your innermost dominant thought is about how you want your life that's coming true. Your innermost dominant thoughts about how you want your life that's coming true. Not the thoughts about the way you fantasize it's not coming true, but the key element is what is evidently coming true, what is showing and surfacing. It's important to look at what is actually unfolding. Because so many people have these fantasies. I think about how I want to be wealthy and everything else, but they never show any evidence of getting wealthier. But it's got to show evidence of coming true, or at least on the way to coming true. So what is it you think about that you actually bring about? Because your innermost dominant thought does become your outermost tangible reality, and your innermost dominant thought is based on your highest values. The next one is, what do you envision? How do you envision your life that's gradually coming true? And it's very similar to what you've been thinking about, except now it's just the visual right hemisphere part of the brain. What are you envisioning about how you want your life that's gradually coming true? How are you envisioning it? I've envisioned myself stepping foot on every country in the face of the earth, sharing my research findings with people around the world, and I'm watching that one by one, country by country, unfolding. I've been in over 90 countries now. So I just see that, and I now realize that. If it wasn't coming true, it doesn't matter. That's fantasy. But the ones that are gradually coming true, how do you envision your life? How many of you know you have visions about how you want your life that's slowly but surely coming true? My daughter, she's at RMIT Fashion School in Melbourne, Australia. And she's had a dream since she's very young, because she's always been in fashion, of having her own fashion empire. She's now hooked up with a guy who's the number one fashion designer in Sri Lanka, actually. And she's about to meet Christian Dior. And she's got a bunch of stuff going on. She's 23 years old, and that's her dream. And she's on her way to make that happen. There's no doubt, nothing's going to stop her. Even her boyfriend, she says, look, I'm busy right now. You can come by at 9 o'clock. I got things to do. She's very focused on this objective. So there's an indicator that that's a high value for her. You look at what it is that you visualize, that you crystallize, that's happening, evidence. The next one is what you internally talk to yourself. How many of you know you have internal dialogue? Yes? And I'm not talking about the crazy noise, the doubtful stuff. I'm talking about talking to yourself about how you want your life that's coming true. The internal dialogue about how it you really, truly want it, that you're showing evidence of working towards and actually coming true on it. Mine's, I'm an international professional speaker traveling all over the world to speak, inspiring people all over the world, that kind of thing. The internal dialogue about how you want your life that's coming true. And if you haven't actually listened carefully to what that is a very strong indicator. And you can take command of it. Once you know what your values are, you can structure that in such a way that it's actually a checkup from the neck up to make it come true. The next one is, what do you converse with people when you're in social settings about most? Would you agree when people come up to you and if their highest value is their children, they go, how's your kids? And if their highest value is business and finance or their investments, they'll say, how's your business and finance doing? Or if they're into fitness, have you worked out lately? Where are you? How's your workouts coming? If they're into sports, what do you think of that last game? They keep asking questions that revolve around the things that are most important to them. So what do you talk about most, and what is it you come alive when you get to talk about most in social settings? That gives you an indication of what your values are. And if somebody starts talking about the laws of the universe or about human behavior, I'm alive and awake. But you start talking about cake decorating or hemming skirts or mechanics on cars. I haven't driven a car in 21 years. That's weird, isn't it? Very strange person. But I haven't driven in 21 years. I always envision myself on my long-term vision of having other people drive me. So that's what I do. I don't drive. But it's basically, you know, what do you talk about? I talk about basically what I love doing, which is human behavior and speaking and things of this nature. So what is it you consistently talk to and want to talk about in social settings and come alive when you get to talk about it? Would you agree it could be 10 to 12 o'clock at night? People could be talking about things. You're kind of tired. You want to go home and you're looking to watch. And all of a sudden the conversation changes to what's important to you and you get the second wind. You come alive again. Yes. That's what I'm looking for. That's a sign of what's valuable to you. The next one is, what is it that inspires you and what is common to the people who have inspired you? What inspires you and what is common to the people who have inspired you? That gives you an indication of what's really important to you. You know, what inspires me is people that have had amazing challenges and they turned them into incredible opportunities and done extraordinary things in the world. Yes? That's what inspires me. I love reading the biographies of those people. I love meeting people that do that. And I've met a lot of people that have done extraordinary things that way. And that inspires me. And I want to do something inspiring in my life. I want to live an inspired life. How many would love to live an inspired life? I believe we all do. So Lou, what is it that inspires you? That's number 11. Number 12 is, what is the most consistent goals that you've had that you consistently focus on that are coming true? Now, this is very similar to the thinking and visualizing and affirming, but what are the goals that you've had that are gradually coming true? If you look at what those 12 determinants are, and let's say you answered three answers for each of those 12, so you have 36. If you go onto my website and pull out those forms, it'll ask you to fill out three answers for each of those questions. When you do, you summarize them, you have 36, and then you go to the front and you look at how many times something showed up. You'll see the same answer showing up again and again. So in other words, if you fill your space, it may be books. If you spend your time reading, you spend your energy studying, you spend your money, books. I'm using this as an example. They may really be saying the same thing, aren't they? And what's common to them? So if you look at what's common to the 36 different answers and which shows up most frequent, second most frequent, third most frequent, you'll see the priorities that you live your life by. Are you with me on that? You'll see what your life is demonstrating. And once you see what your life is demonstrating, you can now set goals that are congruent with that. There is a law in life and in business called Parkinson's Law. And Parkinson's Law states that if you don't fill your day with high priority things, it will automatically get consumed by low priority things. If you don't fill your day with high priority things, it will automatically get consumed by low priority things. Another analogy is if you have a garden and it's just soil, if you don't plant flowers in the garden of what you love to have, it's beautiful flowers, it will fill up with weeds. The mind will automatically and our life will automatically fill up with things that despise us and are low priorities if we don't dictate what's high priority. And nobody, would you agree, nobody's going to get up in the morning and dedicate their lives to our fulfillment. Nobody's going to get up and say, okay, I'm dedicated to having your life fulfilled. So just tell me what it is and I will help you fulfill your life. Nobody does that. So if you're not doing it and nobody else is doing it, you're not likely to have a fulfilling life. You're not going to live your dream life unless you decide what that is. And it is always an expression of what's highest on your value. Because that is what's most important. That's what's most fulfilling. That's what's most inspiring. That's where you're most disciplined. That's where you'll automatically do not require motivation. So identifying that and setting a goal to do that. In your career, if you find out what that is, and you direct yourself in the direction of those are the talents you won't let yourself down in. This is the area you'll discipline yourself in. Finding a career where you're able to fulfill your highest values is the most meaningful career pathway you're going to find. And most people don't give themselves permission to be an entrepreneur, so they work for other people and inject the values and expectations of other people and don't have fulfilling. That's why they are looking for holidays. As far as I'm concerned, every day is a holiday. I don't think about taking time off. When you're doing something you love to do, you don't take time off. You take time off when you're not doing it. Does that make any sense? I mean, if I had time extra, I'd do more of what I love doing. I don't know if that makes any sense. Most people don't live that way. But the real truth is, it can. But you first have to know yourself. As the Delphic Oracle said, know thyself, be thyself, love thyself. Know what your highest self is. Your highest value is your identity. That's who you are. That's your ontology. Knowing what that is. And now, writing down the priorities in life. I learned from Mary Kay, Cosmetics. You've heard of Mary Kay? The Pink Cadillac group? I used to speak for her group. Met her one time in the Anatole in Dallas, Texas. And I asked Mary Kay if there's any advice she could offer me as a young, in my 20s, a young aspiring international speaker. And she said, every day, write down the 6 or 7 highest priority actions you can do that day that will help you fulfill what is most meaningful to you, your most ambitious dreams. And I wrote those down on a little index card every day. I meditated. I wrote down the 6 or 7 highest priority actions I can do today that will help me fulfill my dreams. That way I was focusing on my priorities. And then I went out and did those that day. And then I kept those cards and I accumulated them. And then I decided one time to go back and look at what was the priorities of the priorities. What was the most common thing that I found in the 6 or 7 highest priority action steps? And it boiled down for me as to research, write, travel, and teach. I narrowed down the priorities of the priorities. And then once I identified that, I knew what was most important to me. Then I made a commitment that over the next so many weeks, months, or years, I'm going to work at doing nothing but that and delegate the rest away. And so I basically started focusing. And when you focus on the things that are inspiring to you, you have more energy. You have a clear vision. You can articulate better. You awaken your leadership. You can't wait to get up in the morning and be of service with that. When you do, you receive more self-worth. You feel more net worth. You then can delegate more and give other people jobs by Ricardo's law and give them opportunities to do something they love to do. And then you hire them doing the things that they love to do of the things you want to delegate. Now you give them jobs, you give yourself freedom to get on to doing more important things, you create a career around what you love doing, you're more inspired, you can't wait to get up, you stay more youthful, because when you get up and you got a break on and you're not inspired by what it is, you age quicker. And when you're unfulfilled, you're more likely to go off on tangents of immediate gratification and addiction. Addictive behavior is a byproduct of an unfulfilled highest value. So when you see people addicted, it's because they have not found a way of fulfilling what's most important, and they're probably subordinating to other people, thinking they should be living other people's lives and living in a fantasy. Their life doesn't match it. They're somewhat despaired and despondent, and they feel unfulfilled, and they're looking for immediate gratification through sex or drugs or alcohol or whatever to try to feel better about themselves. How many are with me on that? But by identifying what's important, by following those value determinants, which you can get off the website, and actually go in there and identify it and start structuring your life that way. Let's say you're in a career right now that may not be the most fulfilling, and you'd like to move on to something else, but you're not sure exactly what it is. Just know that if you're not deciding what it is, you're probably going to stay stuck in what you're doing. And if you don't decide, somebody else decides. Any area of your life you don't empower, somebody's going to overpower you. And you're not a victim of their over-empowerment, you're simply not empowered. And when you're empowered, you're doing what you love. So if you're in a job and you're having job descriptions that are not inspiring to you and you can't wait to get away on Friday to get away from it, you don't want to go back on Monday, my advice, go through the value determining process, determine what's really most important to you. Start making a commitment that I'm going to start building my career path and think about it and do a business plan about what you want in life. And then take the job you have now, make a list of everything you do in that, and ask how is each one of those steps actually on the way, not in the way, and helping you fulfill your values. The quality of your life is based on the quality of the questions you ask. If you ask amazing questions, how is this helping me, and how is it on the way, not in the way, you will start to appreciate the job as a stepping stone to do whatever it is you want to do next. Because if you look back, you'll find out that whatever you've been through and whatever career you've been, it wasn't a mistake. It was teaching you a necessary ingredient you needed to go to the next step. And if you can see things on the way, you can be grateful for life. And when you're grateful for life, you have more fulfillment in life. I was taught by my mother, if you're grateful for what you got, you get more to be grateful for. I was born on Thanksgiving Day in America. And you've probably noticed I have many books. One of them is Count Your Blessings, called Count Your Blessings. I think you have it here. And Count Your Blessings is a really powerful book on how to be grateful for what you have so you can have more to be grateful for in all areas. But if you're grateful and you're basically delegating lower priorities and get on with higher priorities, you can't wait to get up in the morning and do it. And would you agree when you have that attitude, if you go to a store and when somebody loves what they're doing, can you feel the difference? Can you see they go the extra mile? They don't seem to be working. They seem to be effortlessly going on doing what they love to do. And you want to do business with them. And when you can't wait to go to work and do that, people can't wait to get your service. That's the difference between living according to your highest values and lowest values. If you want to have a fulfilling career, you have to identify what that is. You have to link what your job duties are daily to that, or you have to structure it in such a way where you've delegated everything else that's not inspiring and get on to doing what is inspiring. I love researching, writing, traveling, and teaching. Everything else is delegated away. I research every day, I write every day, I travel most every day, and I teach every day. Those are the four things that I love doing. Now, some people go, oh, I wouldn't want that life. Great. You have a different set of values. No two people have the same set of values in life. No two people have the same dreams. Thank God. If we were all the same, it wouldn't work, would it? We all need to be different in order to make the thing work. And if you get married, you know that whatever you think is unimportant is what they think is important. So the purpose of marriage is to not have happiness. That's an illusion. The purpose of marriage is to attract somebody you can delegate low-priority crap to who love doing it. Does that make any sense? And you get cheap labor costs. I'm joking. At least I thought it was cheap labor costs, but it actually turns out to be cash. The things they like doing. Now, a wise man will always take whatever the woman, his wife, spends money on and buy stock in it. So if she buys Victoria's Secret model stuff, you buy stock in Victoria's Secret. If it's Jimmy Choo shoes, you buy stock in Jimmy Choo shoes. You got it? So at least you get at least 5% back on your money. The dividends back on the stock report. It's supposed to be a joke there. How many are with me so far? This time is flipping by. I'm getting a sign back there. I've got 2 minutes left. Oh, gosh. But we can do some questions and answers. So watch now. There's something that stops people from actually doing this. There's one thing I want to share, and then we'll go to questions. There's seven fears that immobilize us and stop us from living our true mission, our true most valuable dream life. And you truly can live an amazing life. I live an amazing life today, and I am absolutely certain it's doable. And I didn't start out that way. As hard, you may have this hard to believe, but I lived on the streets when I was a teenager. I remember literally sleeping over vents to keep warm, living in bowling alleys, finding crackers and ketchup in diners to eat on. I know what it's like to have kind of nothing. And so I've been on both levels. I've been in the most impoverished level. I've also now have the big yachts and the penthouses. I know what it's like to have both extremes. And none of those really matter. What matters is if your heart is doing what you love to do and you're inspired. Does that make any sense? Having nothing or having everything teach you something. Each one teaches you. And there's pains and pleasures in each one. But doing something that's meaningful to you and feeling a fulfillment in life is what accounts. And my experience is whenever you're congruent, you grow and expand in each areas, which is what happened to me. And that's why I love what I do, because I remember there laying face down in a tent one time, almost dead. And I thought, if I can live through this thing, I want to do something amazing with my life. And that's when I set my mind, when I was 17, to do the life I wanted to do. And it doesn't matter when you do it, it's just a decision. And once you make that decision and there's no turning back and you're congruent with your values, extraordinary things can happen to people. I've seen amazing things happen to people of all ages as I travel the world by following the principles that stand the test of time. So here's seven fears that can immobilize you, and we'll take a little questions time. The first fear is a fear that I'm not smart enough. Has anybody ever said, I'd love to do something, but I don't think I have the degree, the intelligence, the creativity, the imagination, the smarts, the brain power to pull it off? Anybody been there before? Use that as a fear? That stops people. The second fear, and by the way, that fear is actually a byproduct of minimizing yourself to somebody you think has more intelligence than you. Because you don't feel that fear when you're around people you know are dumb. You only hang out, when you're hanging out with people you think are smarter than you, that's when you get that fear and it mobilizes you. The next fear is the fear of failure. You feel you're going to fail. You know what you would love to do, but you feel you're going to fail at it. So you start lying to yourself saying, I don't know what I want to do. I do a program called the Breakthrough Experience. I do it pretty well every weekend, 43 times a year. And every week somebody comes to me and says, I don't know what I want to do. And I said, bullshit. That's not true. I said, you know exactly what it is, but you just have fears immobilizing it. Your highest value is pulling you and calling you to do something constantly, what's inspiring to you. So you don't want to lie to yourself. If you lie to yourself saying you don't know what you're doing, you're lying. The truth is you do know, but come up. The fear of not being smart enough, intelligent enough, creative enough, the fear of failure. If I do it, I might fail. And then they'll think I'm stupid. And then I won't feel smart enough. You see it? They compound these fears. But the fear of failure can stop people. But the real truth is if it's something really important to you, even if you didn't make it the first time, you get up and do it again, wouldn't you? Imagine if a child, the first time he got up to walk, it said, I'm not doing it. It'd be going against its natural nature, wouldn't it? It's natural for it to want to walk. It's natural for you to do something extraordinary. But when you say, I have the fear of failure, you immobilize yourself because you're comparing yourself to people you think have more success than you, and then you hold yourself back. The third fear is a fear of not making money at something, or the fear you're going to lose money pulling it off, trying to do it. Raise your hand if you've ever had that one. You really have this great idea, but you're afraid you might be, you might lose money at it, or might not make money at it. Then you'd feel like a failure, and then you feel stupid. So then the fears start compounding. Anybody been there before? They start compounding, don't they? And so again, that's another illusion, because if you really, 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 really care about doing something, you won't stop. You'll persevere. You'll endure pain and pleasure in the pursuit of something that's really important to you. And if you do not make money at it, it's because you're not caring about human beings, because you make money by serving people. And if you're focused on yourself and not serving people, then money is automatically not to be made to teach you to serve people. And serving people is not sacrificing yourself for them. Serving people is finding out what's inspiring to you and how to share it with them and find the people that need what you have, what your talents are, directly or indirectly. The next fear is the fear of losing loved ones or the respect of loved ones. And I've watched many people that have a career, they're uninspired in it, but it's secure. They've got a family, they've got a couple kids, they've got a wife, they've got a house, she wants the security, and he wants to do something different, but he can't and feels trapped because if he does it, my wife will be upset and she will leave me if I don't give her security, and if I take a risk, I might not succeed and I might feel stupid and I might fail, I might lose money, and then the house will be in jeopardy and then I'll lose my wife. I've seen this many, many times. So now the fear of loss of loved ones can make you what? Also fear the loss of money and make you feel like a failure, make you feel stupid. It goes around the wheel, doesn't it? The next fear is the fear of rejection. Anybody ever have that one? Fear of rejection. Do you know that you don't care if somebody's a nobody and they reject you and judge you, it doesn't bother you. The only people that you fear rejection from are people you put above you. Anybody you put above you, you have a fear of rejection of. That means if you think that they're more socially empowered than you or have more influence than you or their opinion matters more than yours, that's when you have the fear of rejection. But if you just have some guy walking down the street you don't care about their opinion, and that guy rejects you, you just go, well, that's their opinion, whoopee-doo. It's only people you've subordinated to. In fact, every one of these fears are subordination fears. You've subordinated to somebody who thinks their opinion is more important than you. You're infatuated with somebody, you fear the loss of somebody. Because you never fear the loss of somebody you actually, unless you're infatuated with them. That makes sense? When you resent somebody and he leaves, you celebrate, don't you? You don't have the fear of loss of the person. But if you're infatuated with the guy and he leaves, you're devastated. You see, if you have him above you and you minimize yourself, your fear of losing it. If you're and they're a nobody, you fear of having around. You want to get them gone. The next fear is a fear of not being beautiful enough, not being strong enough, vital enough, healthy enough. And I've seen this many times, I've seen this with women particularly, with their beauty, because women and beauty tend to go together, and so they have a high value on beauty, because that's their power, one of the powers. And so in the process, if all of a sudden somebody else comes along that they're a little anxious about, that might have more beauty than their, and grab the attention of the guy or whatever, they can be insecure about that, and they can have fear of not being beautiful enough. I mean, you know what I'm talking about. Anybody been in one of those boats before? Only one woman here? I know better than that. But we can have that fear. Same thing for guys. Fear can, you know, guys can fear, oh my God, I'm losing my hair. You know, my ass is starting to sag. I don't have the washboard abs anymore. My teeth are falling out, you know. And oh my God, my wife all of a sudden is wanting to get, she's a cougar now that she's got the money. She wants the younger man. These things are fears, yes? Okay? So the fear of not having the body or the vitality or the looks or the beauty or the health, we fear health issues sometimes. And the last fear is the fear of breaking the morals and ethics of some spiritual authority. I'm amazed at how many people get caught in dogmatic religious constructs and coordinate to that, and then they try to live by these dogmas, and then it's not really them, but they're afraid of not following it because they think they're going to get burned in the stakes of hell or something like that, yes? And they're really into this fear mode. And the reality is that that's not necessarily a truth. That's just a belief system they can get stuck in and get in fear about. Now, what's interesting is, if you put those fears together and put all seven of them together, you immobilize yourself, you lie to yourself, you act like you don't know what's really important to you, but the truth is your life is demonstrating your values, and your highest value is your mission. And if you dedicate your life to fulfilling your highest values, you have a fulfilling life. And if you have a vision clear that's beyond the fears don't stop you. And the fears are simply imbalanced perspectives, and they're subordinations to people around you that you've put on a pedestal. And I'd rather stand on their shoulders than sit in the shadows of anyone. In the Breakthrough Experience program that I teach, I have a methodology where we take the most empowered people on the planet, we find out the traits that we're admiring, that we're looking up to, and then we go and look at where we have those in our life, because we're not missing them. Nothing's missing in us. It's just in a form we're not acknowledging. Once we identify where we don't put them on a pedestal, we don't fear rejection, we don't have these fears stopping us, and we give ourselves permission to do something extraordinary. And I believe that we're here to do that. I believe it doesn't matter what age you are, you still can turn your life and do something amazing with your life. And how many degree you want to make a difference in the world? Welcome to our life. So we can. And you know, the greatest difference we can make is when we're authentic. We're true to ourselves. Because that's where our greatest innovation, creativity, and origination and genius is born in that. We're living true to ourselves. Because we're not trying to be somebody we're not. We're being true to ourselves. That's the original thing, because no two people have the same values. So if we live according to our own values, we're unique. And that's where we have our greatest power. How are we doing so far? This has been helpful? How many are glad to hear today? Good. Can we do some questions and answers? Because I got a few minutes to do questions. I'll walk around with a microphone. Oh, you got one too? You got two mics?
Testing.
So we got one in the back there. Okay, hold on a second. I'm gonna walk over there because I can't hear you. And if I can't hear you, probably nobody else can hear you.
These fears are all very real, but what is your recipe for getting over these fears?
How to overcome fear.
You know, you also mentioned being authentic. That's great, but how do I become authentic if I'm not authentic at this moment?
Okay. Let me define fear. You might want to write this or get this in some way. Fear is an assumption that you're about to experience. Fear is an assumption that you're about to experience in the future. It's always about the future, fear. Fear is an assumption that you're about to experience in the future through your senses or imagination. It's either real or imagined. Fear is an assumption that you're about to experience in the future through your senses or imagination more pain than pleasure, more negative than positive, more challenge than support, more risk than reward, more disadvantage than advantage from somebody or yourself. I'm going to say that again. Fear is an assumption that you're about to experience in the future through your senses or imagination. More pain than pleasure, more loss than gain, more negative than positive, more challenge than support, more risk than reward, more disadvantage than advantage from somebody or yourself. Now, those fears emerge. When I do the breakthrough experience each weekend, I have people with any of those seven fears that I mentioned. Every one of those fears are assumptions that they're about to have more drawbacks than benefits, more negatives than positives. That's why they're fearful. And so they're afraid that something's going to challenge their values more than support it. They're going to have a loss without a gain kind of thing. But if you go through your life, how many of you had a terrible event occur, and then a day, a week, a month, a year, 5 years later, you found out that it was terrific after all? And you look back and you go, thank God that occurred. And you had the wisdom of the ages with the aging process. Yes? Instead of the wisdom of the ages without the aging process. Now, the quality of your life is based on the quality of the questions you ask. If you ask questions now, when you're in the fear, and what are the benefits, what are the advantages, what are the gains, what are the positives, what are the supports that are occurring in this thing that you're frightened by, and balance it, you don't have to have the wisdom of the ages with the aging process. You can have the wisdom of the ages without the aging process. The quality of your life is based on the quality of the questions you ask. Any questions that bring balance to the mind dissolve fear. Let me reiterate that. If fear is an assumption, you're going to get an imbalance, a pain without a pleasure, a loss without a gain, a negative without a positive. That's an imbalanced perspective. And so you're anticipating an imbalanced perspective. If you ask the questions that balance whatever the imbalances are, you dissolve the fear. Now, if you fear that, oh my God, I might lose money doing it, you ask the question, if I was to lose money, what would be the benefits? If I did, so how would I benefit? And you can also ask, and what can I do to put a contingency plan in to reduce the probability of me losing it? So you have a contingency plan for the probability, and you can ask the benefits of it to occur so you don't have to be in fear. Donald Trump. You've all heard of Donald, yes? By the way, that is his hair. It's not a wig. Pardon me? It is his hair, yeah. I used to live in Trump Tower, right beneath him. And sometimes we would go down the elevators together in the morning on the way to work. And one morning, we were on our way down. Well, actually, it was at lunchtime. We were going on our way down. And we chatted in the elevator. We got down to the bottom. And we're in the lobby. And there were 12 people waiting for him, part of his team. As we were going down, and we went through the circular door, we went down to 56 and 5th corner, because that's where it is. And we were about to go across the street, waiting for the light. I was listening to the conversation he was having with his team. And what he was doing, it was taking, he was getting ready to do the Hudson River Project, where he's building a whole bunch of buildings along the Hudson River. And he was asking his team, I want to know everything that could go wrong with this project. Anybody that's not willing to sell their property that we need to buy. Any municipalities that aren't going to allow us to get permits. Any pipes, any electricity, anything, cemeteries, anything that could throw this project off. I want you to find everything that could go wrong. I want you to come up with a contingency plan, a dozen contingency plans for everything to go wrong, so if we're faced with it, we know exactly what to do. So he was not seeing negative without a positive. He was saying, let's find the negatives, let's find the benefits, let's find out how we use it to our advantage, and move forward. A person that lives in fear is a person that's living in a fantasy. You might want to write this. You'll never have a phobia without a philia. You'll never have a phobia without a philia. A philia is an assumption that you're going to experience in the future through your senses or imagination, right? More pleasure than pain, more positive than negative, more gain than loss, etc., etc. The other side. So philias are fantasies about getting a positive without a negative. Whenever you set up a philia, you have an unrealistic expectation on the reality of life, Because life has a balance. It's got two sides to the coin. And anytime you set up a philia, you're going to have a phobia. So if you're having a phobia, you're anticipating assumption that you're supposed to get a positive without a negative, a happy without a sad kind of thing. When you know that life has both pain and pleasure, positive and negative, two sides of life, you set real goals with real times, and you don't have philias or phobias. And this is what Donald was good at. He knew that there were pains and pleasures in every project. He knew to have contingency plans for the pains. He knew not to get elated about the highs. He knew to hone himself centered and center himself. People who set up phobias for themselves are actually people addicted to philias. Depression is a comparison of your current reality to a fantasy that you're addicted to. I'm going to say that again. Depression is a comparison of your current reality to a fantasy that you're addicted to. The phobia of depression is balanced by the philia of the addiction that you're addicted to. You're expecting one-sidedness and not appreciating both-sidedness. When you get married, right, if you have an fantasy that this guy is going to be give you more positives and negatives, more gains and losses, can you see you're setting yourself up for the setback, the drawback? Because they don't make guys like that. Does that make sense? The Creator made sure that the guys have just enough negatives to balance out any positives you might get. So if you're in a fantasy, can you? And then what happens if you're in a fantasy and you're addicted to the fantasy, you're frightened of it not staying that way. And so you've set up a phobia because of the philia. Am I making sense here? So every one of the phobias that I just mentioned are a result of subordinating to people you put on a pedestal, which is the philia. And then you fearing that you're going to lose that philia, that addiction to the fantasy, and then you're having a fear. If you have a balanced orientation and a balanced expectation, phobias and philias dissolve and fulfillments are set in. Better to have a fulfillment. Now, if you think that you're not being authentic, the truth is you are living, every decision you make is based on your values. And you're living according to your values right now. Every decision you make is based on. The only time you think that you're unfulfilled or you feel like you're making mistakes or you think you're sabotaging is when you're expecting yourself to live outside your real values and expecting yourself to live in the values that you've injected from other people. And whenever you have, now you're feeling unfulfilled and you think you're unauthentic. But in truth, your decisions are still based on your real values. But you're not honoring yourself because you keep comparing yourself to other people. If we compare ourselves to other people and not compare our own actions to our own dreams, we actually interfere with our fulfillment in life. Am I making sense here? Nobody's worth putting on pedestals or pits, but everybody's worth putting in hearts. We're here to have reflective awareness, not a comparison. I hope that answered the question. I think I have only one question left. I think I'm out. Yes? Yes. Stress, I just did an interview for SAB1 today. Was it one? SAB1. It won't be coming out for a bit, but I was just down there. They're doing a teen show for science and teens. Have you seen this? And they've asked me to be on this. It's the second time I've been on this last month. And we talked about adapting to stress. So listen really carefully. Stress is the inability to adapt to a changing environment. Stress is the inability to adapt to a changing environment. Now, would you agree that the environment is constantly changing? You're not going to stop that. So if you can't adapt, that's because you're infatuated with something the way it is, or you're frightened about what's about to come. So you have a philia about the way it is that you want to hold on to, and you're fearing the loss of that, or you're fearing a gain of something you don't want to happen. Now, we have a biological, ecological source of that fear. Way back in our genetic code, there's a thing called ubiquitous hormones and ubiquitous physiology that is, it's in every form of life that there is, all the way single-celled organisms up. And there's a, inside the food chain, there's a thing called predators and prey. Prey is the food we want to eat, and predators are the things that want to eat us. And we have that in our life. Anybody we infatuate with, we want to eat. Have you ever been so infatuated with somebody you wanted to eat them? But anybody we resent, we don't want to be eaten by. We want to avoid, yes? So the fear of loss of that which we infatuate with, the food, and the fear of gain of that which we resent are the two biological, most primitive fears we have. But that's because we're infatuated with things with philics, and we're resentful to things with phobics. If we learn to ask questions that balance the mind, the philias and the phobias dissolve and we're adaptable to a changing environment. So the more black and white we are, would you agree if you go to areas in the Middle East where there's a lot of black and white thinking, I'm right, you're wrong, I'm right kind of thing, that's where the highest stress zones are. So the more adaptable you are, the less polarized your perceptions are. You're more adaptable because you can adapt to life's changes that way. So if you're infatuated with somebody, you're going to fear their loss. If you resent somebody, you're going to fear their gain. If you love somebody, you're going to adapt. And love is a balance. I will say this one last thing. When you're infatuated with somebody, you see more similarities and differences. How many have been infatuated and go, oh my God, we have the same number of eyes, same number of ribs, same number of teeth. We're soulmates. When we're resentful to somebody, we see more differences and similarities. Oh my God, we don't have the same ideas. We're going in two different directions, more differences. When you see more differences and similarities, you're resentful. When you see more similarities and differences, you're infatuated. When you see a balance of similarities and differences, you have love. Because you wouldn't want to be exactly with you wouldn't want to be married to somebody who's exactly like you, drive each other crazy. If any two people are exactly the same, one's not necessary. So you want a balance of similarities and differences, which means if you embrace the balance of life, the positives and the negatives, the supports and the challenge equally, in a balanced way, you're the most adaptable to a changing environment, you have the least stress.
For more information about Dr. John Demartini, his live events and range of products, contact the Demartini Institute on info@drdemartini.com. To view our website, visit www.drdemartini.com.